Okay. Okay, Cameron, you have our full attention.
Alright, so I'm glad everyone made it here despite the thunderous rain we're about to have from judging by the clouds. My presentation is going to be on a topic I've done a lot of research on and am very passionate about. So it's relating to mental health. So before I go any further into this, I want you all to think about if you hear a client or somebody you know has a mental health condition, what does that person look like? You know, maybe you have somebody you know that has a condition, but if you were to say you don't have somebody you know, what would that person look like to you? So just take a moment, kind of picture what that person, what you vision people with a mental health disorder have. Hopefully, none of you think of this. So now, while these extreme cases do exist, the point of today's topic is not to deal with the more extreme kind of criminal defense sort of stuff. Today we're going to be talking about, particularly for lawyers in practice, they're going to be working with people that have mental health conditions, or even in the representation of a client that may have a mental health condition, or even those of you that are going into the field, chances are you're probably going to end up working with someone with mental health condition. Now, the condition really isn't important to how you handle those with diminished capacity or those that you think may have diminished capacity. That's not really important to the area. Maybe it's useful for you to know for certain ways you handle business, and I'll give some examples of that. But some of you may be thinking, well, I'm not going to be dealing with people with mental health illness. You know, I'm working in environment, or I'm working in taxes, or I'm working, you know, in an area where you don't think it's going to populate. In fact, that's probably not the case, because 1 in 4 people are going to have some kind of mental health problem during their life. So there are 8 of us in this room. If that statistic holds true, 2 of us potentially could have a mental health condition. So it's very prevalent. And even though it may not be the core of the legal issue you're dealing with, it is something to take into account when you're working with those that have a mental health condition or you're interviewing them. So I'm going to talk primarily today about the tips and the roles of the lawyer that are representing those with mental health conditions. And then at a later point, we're going to talk a little bit about the competency and the ethics around it, because that's very important in these cases. And one of the things I want to mention up front is, although your role as a lawyer does not change, you still have that same obligation to provide a specific legal service. The ways you go about it are going to change, because competency should always be at the forefront of your mind. It's a very fluid area, but you should always have the presumption of competency, unless you have something to think that that's otherwise. But we'll talk about that in a little bit. So as I said, your role does not change. Actually, really, most of what you're doing will not change.
Thunderstorm.
So you may be wondering, why does this look like kind of armchair psychology thing? Well, in these cases where there is an underlying mental health condition, the more common conditions you're going to run across are depression, anxiety, obsessive compulsive, they're going to have organizational issues, and they're going to be particularly fragile in terms of emotional states, for the most part. Some conditions may not have the emotional aspect, but being aware of the emotional aspects of these clients is really important, because I would imagine most of you have had clients where they come in and they are emotional, and that can actually be heightened when there's a mental health condition as well. So actually acknowledging that emotional side of the client and kind of taking on those emotions and allowing that client to vent those to you is actually really important. It's going to help you build that client relationship, and it will actually help you get to the facts faster rather than trying to be very pointed right from the beginning, where you might be with a client that doesn't have some of the emotional stuff going on. But what you don't want to do, you're not the therapist. And from the very beginning, you want to make very clear in these cases what your role is. And you want to have policies wherever you're working that's going to have access to be able to refer people to individuals that maybe need counseling services or have other referral agencies. At least have an internal policy of where to send these individuals to. Because from our office, we've had several cases where, one in particular, a woman came in for a utility problem. Utility problem was solved, but she keeps calling. because we are oftentimes, as lawyers, the first point of contact. We're seen as an authority figure, and we've helped them once, so they think we can solve all of their problems. So even though you've made it very clear, you know, this is how I've represented you, and maybe you've signed a retainer waiver, you need to continually make these kinds of efforts. And documentation and having those referrals is probably, well, the most important thing in dealing with these types of individuals. So one of the biggest things, I think, when you're interviewing or working with a client is don't be afraid to set time limits. You can sometimes get wrapped up in the client's narrative because they have a very compelling story, and you know, you're going to want to have empathy for them. You can kind of get sucked into that. And while it's important to be able to kind of triage those kinds of concerns, you still want to keep in mind that you have a viable practice and you have to have specific time limits. So don't be afraid to set time limits and be very clear about that. And sometimes you are going to have to be very stern. I've had several clients that just, you know, we have a 30-minute meeting and they're going to want to chop to you all day. So you have to be very clear and very organized, probably in these cases more than any. So some other interview tips. As I mentioned, kind of tackling that emotional aspect head on is a lot more poignant, but that's also kind of balanced by the fact that there are points when you want to jump in. So if the emotion is clouding the entire reason for why they're there to the point where you're not getting anywhere, you want to go in with very precise questions. So asking them to generally recall their financial situation or generally recall facts is actually going to make them feel under pressure. They're not going to oftentimes be able to recall that kind of general information, and it's going to affect the accuracy. So the more specific you can be with what date was that this did this happen on, that's going to help them kind of get back to where they can start giving you concrete facts. So understanding the underlying legal issue is really important, and having a very clear set of facts that you want to get out of them is a point where you want to jump in when the emotion has really overridden the fact-gathering piece of it. Another big area is using plain language. So lawyers in particular are very, we have a very specific set of language that we use, and they're not always going to be very clear, even when we think it's clear. Kind of having a very specific plain language and explaining what you mean when you say a certain term is particularly important here. And a lot of these tips, you know, are irrelevant to really any kind of interview, but these are just additional helps that you can do as you go along with these clients. Another thing to keep in mind is, as I said, capacity is very fluid, and the capacity can change throughout the interview. So you can have capacity for them to, you know, explain the situation and understand that they're there, but you could get through the interview and realize that perhaps they don't have the capacity to sign a retainer waiver right there. Sometimes you may have to send the retainer with them, explain what it is, give them time to like review it, schedule a separate meeting to come back and actually do the retainer agreement. So you don't want to pressure them into making quick decisions, because oftentimes with regular clients and even those that have emotional or psychological underpinnings, they're just going to agree to whatever you put in front of them. I've seen that a lot in practice where, you know, they'll just nod along, and you really, for ethical reasons, need to ensure that they're really understanding what it is they're deciding and what they're agreeing to. Another big area is you always want to have a presumption of competency. So we're actually going to move into the competency piece of it. So as I've said a couple times, it's fluid. You always want to be aware of it. The main rule is 1.14, and that's under the model rules. Rhode Island tracks that exact same language. Actually, when I looked it up, it's the same rule. So there's no real difference in that. Procedure's pretty much exactly the same. And you really want to kind of make sure that those clients are aware of their rights, aware of the decisions they're making, and you really want to watch for some red flags. So there's a lot more, and I actually have a handout that gives you all, I'll just give you this half. It's from the sources at the top, but it's in a collaboration with the American Psychological Association and the American Bar Association that assesses those with aging Diminished capacity in elderly is what the journal comes out of. It's extremely useful. I was going to actually make one on my own, but then when I found this, I realized I'm not going to be able to produce anything better. So as you can see, there's a host of areas that you kind of want to watch for when you're dealing with someone that has capacity issues. Some of the main ones that I see very common that are just things to kind of watch for are if the client's not able to really interact with the lawyer, if they're just kind of nodding along, they're not really adding anything to the conversation, that's an area of capacity. If they have someone with them that, you know, hasn't made clear that they're the guardian or that they are the legal proxy in that case, that can be an area where you kind of maybe there's a competency issue if the person with them is doing the primary talking. And then another big one is if they're having difficulty recalling. I mean, some of these are just very generalized. If they're having difficulty recalling specific facts, that could be almost anybody. But none of these in of themselves actually indicate, you know, with the exception of clear delusions, would indicate competency issues by themselves. Like it's a form where you kind of have to get a feel while you're in practice for how much is this adding up? Do I really think there's a competency issue? And a lot of the forms and scholar articles say that attorneys can actually make the competency evaluation themselves. I would actually caution against that. If I were having policies and practices, if I felt there was a real competency issue, yes, you've made the determination that you feel that they aren't competent to actually, you know, contract your services or make a specific decision, but I would send, if you really think that somebody has to take over the case and step in for them, that kind of competency decision should be made by a different professional, either, you know, someone that has the degree through the courts, or the judge can sometimes also offer those competency evaluations. You can do the order. So I would really encourage having those kind of, where someone else is taking over in place of the individual, to have those competency decisions made outside your office and done by the courts or done by a professional. I feel it's a much better, it saves you time and it saves you from making any ethical errors. One other very crucial thing is, I didn't want to start a lot on statistics, but another cool thing to talk about in Rhode Island is it's very common here in Rhode Island. Of the 1.1 million residents in Rhode Island, 38,000 adults have a mental health illness. So, very common here, and every 15.8 seconds, someone passes away from suicide, often the result of an underlying mental health condition. So in the time it took to do this presentation, we've lost someone to an untreated mental health condition. So representation is really important in these cases. Thank you. Any questions?
I have a question. When you were talking, just that last statistic of the 15.8 seconds, is that Rhode Island alone, or you know?
That's nationally.
Okay.
Yeah. That's a national statistic. So.
Oh, that would have been frightening if it was Rhode Island.
Yeah.
Do you have any tips on if you're sort of unsure your client's mental health condition, have you come across or have you done any work at the center in terms of like the best way to approach that with the client? I mean, it seems really delicate that you don't want to put them on the spot.
Right.
Especially if they're not revealing much.
So the few times I've run across it with the center and particularly with the mental health advocate, the best avenue is actually to really sit them down and have an honest conversation with, you know, are you really, like, we need, there are additional protections that we need, that we can do to ensure that you're having your rights met, and kind of handling it that way rather than making them feel like you're trying to push them off onto somebody else, is the way to handle it when you really think that there's a competency issue. You can also kind of confer with other colleagues that are in the area, kind of explain the situation with as much as you're able to, would be the two areas I would kind of do it. But if you really, really feel that there's a competency where they're just not communicating with you, then yeah, I would order have someone evaluate them just to be sure. And documentation, I should have mentioned, is probably one of the more crucial things in this. Since you're going to have them calling back on different issues, so you want to make sure you're documenting all of that along the way. Anybody else? Thank you.
Thanks, Cameron.
Am I on there?
Sure.
Okay.
Okay. Take your time doing the One more minute, and then if we still need time, just hold on to it. Molly, full attention, go for it, Molly.
Is it okay if I stand in between here?
wherever you're comfortable.
Okay.
Your hands off.
All right. So my name is Molly Ogren, and today I'm going to be doing a little bit of a talk about animal regulation. But before you all go to sleep, let's just talk about some pets really quick. So I love pets. I'm a pet person. I've had two horses in my lifetime. This is O, that's Dart, that's Jasper, my former dog, that's Juno, my former dog. This is not a picture of my actual fish, but this is Ernie, my fish. He lasted 2 weeks, didn't work out. And then this is our new addition to my new family, and this is called Max. So I'm a pet person. So how many of you love pets, want pets, are all about pets? Exactly. And everybody seems to love them. So why is it that we can have pets? And maybe let's talk about exotic pets. How many of you would think it'd be cool to have a monkey in your house? Or a whale? I mean, it's just a large pool, right? If you get a big enough pool, you could have a whale or a tiger. Siegfried and Roy did it, why can't you? So why is it that more often than not that we can have cows, pigs, goats, and yet we can't have tigers and bears, oh my. Why can't we have these? So we had a recent application at DEM recently, and this is public record now, that a gentleman applied for an application to host 5 non-human primates in his backyard in Kingston. And he could demonstrate the financial ability, and he could demonstrate the space. And DEM still said no. Why? Well, because they went on the list and said, you know, you don't have the immunizations, we don't have proper immunizations, you know, you don't have the right veterinary assistance, you don't have the other resources. So that's my topic today. Why state and federal regulations limit individuals from owning exotic pets, even when they can demonstrate the space and the financial ability. So as an example organism, we're going to go one step farther and we're going to talk about dinosaurs. I love dinosaurs. Ever since I got into biology, and every chance I get, I do a presentation on dinosaurs. I'm all about it. And with this whole Jurassic World going on, I mean, how many of you would really love to have a raptor? Chris Pratt can do it, right? Why can't we? So why can't we have dinosaurs? So first, let's classify what an exotic animal is and why a dinosaur classified it as, because some would argue that they're not. So if we use Rhode Island as the regulatory measuring stick, I have the rules and regulations, and I'm just going to pass one copy around. You don't have to rifle through it, but I'm going to read you the relevant portion that Rhode Island defines exotic animals as any vertebrate or invertebrate other than those defined as domestic animals or exempt as exotic animals. So what does that mean? So domestic animals means any animal through an extremely long period of association with humans, bred to a degree that their temperament, color, breeding, conformation, or other attributes have turned so different from the exotic version. I compare this a wolf and a dog. A wolf is clearly not temperate enough to be in a backyard. A dog was in mine. Okay, so breaking this down to English. Dinosaurs are vertebrates. They have a backbone, central paired nervous system. They've got more than just a paired ganglion for a brain. I'm not gonna get too into it. They're not temperate enough to live with humans. I mean, more often than not, they like to eat us. So, and as for color and conformation, we don't know. I wasn't there 250 million years ago. I can't imagine you guys were either. So we don't really know, but we can kind of assume that they haven't changed enough to become domestic, right? So they're an exotic animal. But then before you get going, well, there's those exempt exotic animals, and exempt exotic animals are defined as reptiles, snakes, and birds. And I know some of you lawyers are getting really sneaky and being like, well, they're descendants. Birds and reptiles are descendants of dinosaurs, and that doesn't really work out either, because they're talking about small birds, like small snakes and teids and skinks, things to that effect, okay? So they're not exempt, they're an exotic animal. Now we've defined it, let's look at why Jurassic Park is a perfect example of why you need state and federal regulations to regulate exotic animals, right?
So let's look at back at Jurassic Park 1. All right, you've got John Hammond, and he's got all the money. Remember his famous line, spare no expense? And he's got three giant islands off the coast of Costa Rica, right? Or something to that effect. He's got the space, so why can't he have them? Well, so why didn't it work out? So there wasn't adequate regulation of dinosaurs. And the operators, the facilities, the scientific understanding, they didn't work out. And the famous quote from Dr. Ian Malcolm is, yeah, yeah, but your scientists were so preoccupied with whether they could, they didn't stop to think of whether they should. Now remember this with your own animals. Remember this with the monkey guy in Kingston. He can. He's got the money, he's got the space. Why can't he do it? Should you do it? That's the more important part. So what happened? Dinosaurs got some free lunch, a bit of a jog, new territory, raptors learned how to cook, people got hurt, they died, a lot of money was wasted. So you're thinking, so what? This is on an island, there wasn't that many people that got hurt. What could go wrong? We live in the United States. But if you remember The Lost World Part 2, there was a dinosaur running through San Diego, facing down a child in school, and, you know, let's just go over what happened again. Dinosaurs got some free lunch, a bit of a jog, new territory, raptors stayed home on the island, people got hurt, they died, a lot of money was wasted. So, okay, now all the dinosaurs are back on the island and everything seems to be okay. Then they've got the space, there's no regulation, but there's also no people. So what could go wrong? So you get number three, right? And people decide to do these tours and sightseeing and, oh, we can see it from a distance, but that didn't really work out either, correct? What happened? Dinosaurs got some free lunch, a bit of a jog, new territory, raptors got possessive about some eggs, they died, and a lot of money was wasted. See a theme going on here? So Jurassic World just came out, and apparently we still haven't learned a lesson. Now, although they did seem to have a lot more regulation, there's no spoilers coming up, I promise, but, and they had the space, and they had the money, and they had a lot of corporate revenue stream to help out this money, so the money was going to run out. That seems to work out, right? Yeah? Have I convinced you? No. Dinosaurs got some free lunch, a bit of a jog, new territory, raptors become best friends with Chris Pratt, people died, they got hurt, and a lot of money was wasted. So how does this relate to animal regulation? You never stop to think if you should. You only think if you can, right? So we need the regulations that are implemented to ensure people are safe, people around us are safe, other organisms are safe. Exotic organisms are exotic for that same purpose. They're unpredictable, they're wild, they're something unattainable, okay? So people do it and things go wrong. We've got Siegfried and Roy, who, I don't know if this was relevant over here, but in Vegas there was a huge attack, and Roy, who had raised that tiger since he was a baby, attacked him on stage. You have Tilikum, the whale, drowning its trainer. You have gorillas attacking fences all the time and glass enclosures. You have tiger escapes from San Francisco Zoo that kills a 17-year-old boy. There's news articles all the time about exotic organisms not reacting to the ecology that they're forced to be put into. Because they have the space, they have the money, they don't have these unattainable items. Maybe they do have immunizations, but do they have the ecology, do they have the right atmosphere for an organism? And that's when they start to react. So, not only owning exotic organisms may harm people, but it can harm other organisms. There's a new study that just got released that orcas can live up to 40 years in captivity. The new study shows that orcas living in the wild can live up to 80 years in the wild. That's twice what we thought. Tigers become depressed when they're not enclosed with other tigers. Gorillas attack because they see other people and think that they're in their new territory. So not only is it harming the people, we have to remember that these are animals. It's harming them too. Ecology is about the study of places and interactions with organisms. In ecology, there's this renowned idea of niches. Casey, you have a niche in your apartment. You go home and you call it home, and you've got an Andrew in your apartment, and you say, this is my home, this is where I belong. And maybe Rhode Island is a bigger niche. You understand where the grocery store is. That's your place. That's where you get food. Obi, you go home to your apartment. You understand that this is where you go home and you've got your apartment. Maybe you travel a little farther away, but you know where you can reach out to. Animals have the same thing. So when you take them out of that, let's say transplanting Cameron in the jungle, you're not going to entirely understand how to survive right away. And you're going to react unfavorably, much like gorillas and tigers and dinosaurs. So regardless amount of money and human space humans can provide, some animals need heavy regulation for the safety and common welfare of society. So how does this all play into you guys being lawyers, right? So when you're deciding to have a pet in the future as fancy lawyers, or maybe you have a client that says, these regulations are crap. I have the money and I have the space. Remember the famous line. You always remember if you can do it, but you never think about whether you should do it. So just remember that some pets are not meant to be a pet, like dinosaurs, and that's okay. Any questions? That's a very good question. So if we break this down again, they have the space, they have the money. The important part about zoos, some zoos, yes, and some zoos, no. Some zoos, they have the facilities, they have the right ability to create the atmosphere and the climate and the ecology for the organism, like the San Diego Zoo. I don't know if any of you have been, but the San Diego Zoo is phenomenal because they create an entire climate for these organisms. They really make sure that these organisms have enough space. Zoos that act more as a refuge, so for organisms that are hurt and might die if they don't get the help, that would be okay. They're not treated as pets. But in scenarios where you have an exotic zoo where you have giraffes in your backyard, like I had a neighbor who had giraffes in their backyard, that wasn't okay. The giraffes were in the Sahara and they came to Nevada. That doesn't compare, and that's not okay. So there's a fine line between a zoo and a refuge and creating a habitable area for these organisms versus zoos that aren't up to par with immunizations, with caretaking, with backing off as a human in their world. So that's a very good question, is there is that fine line between resources availability and all the resources, not just space and money, versus having them in your backyard.
With some of these organisms, you're talking maybe it's not necessarily about endangered species, but about maybe threatened species, things like that. Isn't there some value to have, like, because when a person has them as a pet or whatever, I mean, they're closer to society, people are more likely to see them, possibly interact with them, or at least be aware of their presence. Doesn't that, in a way, like raise awareness about the need to like preserve those populations, generally speaking? Like, I mean, you could argue that, like, for instance, like Coco the gorilla that like learns to sign, you know, convey language and stuff, wakes people up to the need to preserve this like majestic, you know, set of animals and make sure they don't go extinct. I mean, isn't there some value in that to maybe having, if people do indeed have the resources to having that sort of thing?
There is value to that, definitely. There's value to using organisms and learning their behavioral ecology, their psychological abilities, their emotional abilities. Yes, there is value to that. But more often than not, and I'm not speaking 100% across the board, that those places create, again, that facility for those organisms and that they're aware of when to back off and when to allow this organism to actually behave like an organism. What I'm talking about is five primates in a backyard where that's not raising awareness towards their extinction or to their value. That's owning them for your own purpose. And it goes down to even smaller organisms. There's a lady in Alaska who has this love of bald eagles. Bald eagles have been in a threatened and endangered species list for years. And she just has them, and she keeps them in her backyard, and the state of Alaska keeps fighting her on it, saying, you need to let them go, because she's not harboring them, she's not keeping them for any value to them or to her, she's just keeping them, where that's when you run into dangerous situations, that's when you run into harmful situations to the animals. We have to remember, as humans, that's great if we use them for our own personal knowledge, but also remember, this is a living being. So it's kind of like using another human for their value and their thoughts and what you can learn from them. You wouldn't put them in a cage. It's kind of the same situation. You wouldn't put them in their backyard, right? So although you raise a good point, we do use, Washoe is the first gorilla or the first primate to learn sign language. And they did. They used him to see if they could teach primates what their capability cognitively is. That's wonderful. But Washoe also had an enclosure that was very vast, and they gave him everything available to him and made sure that he was at home there. When you're working with animals, the slightest change in their ecology, you can tell. Hair falls out. Dietary needs change. Behavior changes. It's very quick, too. It's like taking a three-year-old out of their playpen or taking a three-year-old out of the toy store. They don't like it. They're going to react. It's that much more escalated on an animal scale. I'm going to go to him first.
Can you tell me a little more about the regulation in Rhode Island? You said that there was someone who applied for, I think it was a permit to have the monkeys. So, and you said he demonstrated the space, the money, and everything. Now, is there sort of like a long checklist of everything you have to meet, and then once you meet those, then the permit gets granted, or is there some sort of discretion involved with the DEM?
That's a great question. There is some discretion involved with DEM. It can't be arbitrary or capricious, much like most agencies involved. But in this rule, the requirements, Rule 5, if you like to take a look at it, you can. They do. They have a list where you have to have a state veterinary checkoff. You have to prove that there's immunizations available. The immunizations are, in fact, effective, and that's a big issue. One of the areas that the primate case was dealing with was rabies. Primates can get rabies, but we don't have an immunization for primates to have rabies shots. So there's those issues. It's a very long list of check-off, and then the director will take a look at it, and if they decide that this is not in the best fitness for the organism or for the humans or for the community, then they can also deny it at their discretion, as long as it's not arbitrary and capricious, which means unreasonable. Go ahead.
I was going to say, you said you were from Vegas and your neighbor had an exotic animal in his backyard, and I was just wondering, is Mike Tyson and his tiger your neighbor?
No. No.
So I was just wondering, like, does the DEM have, like, any way of, like, doing checkups on people that have exotic pets? Like, because I would be wondering about somebody who, like, gets, like, a tiger or something, and they just go through the motions of, like, I can show you guys, just to get the permit that, like, I'll put it in this field, but they end up, like, having some other, like, cage or something for it.
That's a, like I said, good question. You guys have great questions. The state veterinarian has to check in on the organism. There's one other part of this, that although you can get a permit for an exotic animal and you can be passed through it, you also are held up to another statute or another act called the Animal Care Act. So anything that the state veterinarian feels as though is not up to standard, they can report them to DEM. DEM can check up on them. They have an office of compliance for these organisms that they can continue to ensure that the animal is being treated nicely and fairly and in the proper way.
What kind of, is there insurance minimums for, like, if you're, I mean, you must have to have, like, a ton of insurance to, like, get, right?
I'm not sure about insurance. I'm not sure how that works, but I can only assume.
Yeah.
I can only assume it's a very hard policy to get.
Yeah, where do you go for that? You don't call Geico.
I'm well insured.
Exactly.
You do
have
Molly.
Thank you.
I got from the hangover.
insurance company.
Yeah, you probably
fight
Starbucks. Yeah.
Something that's big.
I know what to say.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do I have time to use the restroom? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I want
okay.
to take a time to do that. Yeah, please, definitely. We don't want him. You're not going to miss this.
He's a timekeeper. I need to know him.
I wish we had a microphone for you.
I'm sorry. It's okay.
And you need to take a lucky lifesaver.
I'm going to make the best.
You do a good presentation on client confidentiality because I know you're going to keep my secret.
Joining me today. I want to start by telling you a story about a client I met a few weeks ago. And all names if I use are not the names of real clients, I've made them all up. So this client's name is Emily. And Emily is a great woman, but she's having some issues with her house. It's being condemned by the City of Providence for, a list of issues including there's no running water. She doesn't have a staircase she can safely use to access her third floor apartment. There are rats, roaches, and a list of other bugs I do not want to name for you. But I went to her house with my supervisor in order to really assess what this client needs and what was actually going on with her home. I thought about that house for quite some time and it really stuck with me. And my supervisor told me that this is not even the worst house she has seen. The windows in this house were being held together by towels that were stapled to the wall. I could reach my hand through the window and reach the outside. There's no working screen on any of the windows. On the outside of the house, there are discarded windows, I'm assuming that had been replaced, just laying on the ground. This is the children that live in the house's backyard and play space. There's broken glass everywhere, and the tenants have tried their best to clean it up, but unfortunately their efforts are just not enough. The house, like I said, does not have running water. They get water from the store to bathe with, to cook with. It's a really desperate situation that these people are in. And that's just a sample of the clients who come into the medical legal partnership at Hasbro Children's Hospital. And I just wanted to set that up for you, but I don't want this to be a depressing topic. So I decided that since you sat through that story, I was going to treat you to a trip to the Bahamas. So the Medical Legal Partnership is the only one in the state of Rhode Island, and it began in 2012. We service a host of issues for our clients, and we're often their first contact with the legal system, or their first, I'll call it positive contact with the legal system. And today I wanted to tell you why I think the Medical Legal Partnership is like a 5-star hotel in the Bahamas. First, I believe Medical Legal Partnership deals with a lot of housing issues. Like I told you about Emily's case, it's a lot of housing issues for people in the City of Providence, Central Falls, Pawtucket, all over the state of Rhode Island. And the work includes trying to get them on Rhode Island housing so they can have safe and affordable housing. A lot of these clients are extremely low income, relying on oftentimes their child's SSI payments, unemployment payments, unemployment payments of their significant other to make ends meet, and finding reliable and affordable housing is often very difficult for them. But the medical legal partnership really helps navigate through these often difficult experiences for clients who maybe are not experienced talking to people on the phone. English is not their first language, so it really helps break down the barrier that can be a very difficult and trying process. The medical legal partnership also holds landlords responsible, like in Emily's case, for violations that have been outstanding on the home, often for years. They try to really hold landlords accountable for things that the city has ordered that they fix to make sure they're fixed and that they're fixed properly. So for Emily's case, the city of Providence decided to unfortunately condemn the home, but in other cases, we've really forced landlords to fix their problems in a timely and extremely safe fashion. I also think that housekeeping is important. Like I saw in Emily's home, she had a lot of pest problems. This is something that unfortunately a lot of clients of the medical legal partnership deal with, but it's something that I think Janine, my supervisor, has navigated through very successfully. There are a list of exterminators in Providence. I'm just talking about Providence generally because that's where the most of the clients live, who will do exterminations for a low cost or even sometimes for free because of the client's need, which is great. And I know that another client that I met, her name is Crystal. Her house was infested with bed bugs and her children were rushed to the emergency room due to all the bed bug bites that they had on their body. And the exterminator came to the house. I believe it's a host of 3 treatments they do the first time. And the bed bug problem has subsided, for now at least, so it's been a positive experience. And like I said before, that the medical legal partnership helps keep landlords accountable and often will involve city officials and building code inspectors to really hold these landlords accountable for their apartments that they rent out to the public. And my favorite, food. This is a big problem for clients who are extremely low income and often don't know how to navigate the benefit system that's here in Rhode Island. I know that personally during my time at the medical legal partnership, I have called several food shelters, regular shelters for emergency housing to get these clients food. Something very simple that I know I don't think about, and I'm sure a lot of you don't think about, but this is a day-to-day thing for a lot of the clients here. And I think that benefits also include navigating their SSI and SSDI payments. So SSI is for low-income individuals, and SSDI is for workers who are disabled, not necessarily due to an on-job accident, but it's a worker-related program. And like I said, we call food shelters, food banks, in order to get these clients what they need. And most importantly, medical care. It's in the name. It's one of the main things that we focus on. And there's a list of diseases and illnesses that I've been dealing with in my, I think, 6 or 7 weeks now at the medical legal partnership. And some of the interesting ones that I've researched are sickle cell anemia. There's one client who just came in the other day with some GI issues that her daughter has, and even also some psychiatric and emotional issues that clients have. And I think the medical legal partnership really is good at navigating medical illnesses very respectfully, but with the knowledge and research behind them to get clients the best possible care that they need, whether it's referring them to a psychiatrist who maybe has low cost appointments, or a referral within the hospital where they're also normally Medicaid will cover them if they're under the Lifespan, which is the company that Hasbro is located under. There will normally be low-cost services for these clients as well. And with health issues, this is where the majority of the legal issues are. So the medical legal partnership often goes through SSI benefits in the whole case, which can sometimes take years to receive benefits for. But I think it's very important that a lawyer navigate that, because I know if I was an uneducated, oftentimes unsophisticated client, I would not feel comfortable calling the Social Security office in Providence because they give me a hard time. And I'm supposed to be an intern, so they even give me a hard time. Also, we handle a lot of guardianship cases for adult and minor children, and I will say that the judges at the Providence Probate Court are some of the best that I've seen. They really understand the model that the medical legal partnership operates under, which is a holistic approach to legal care and I think the judges there are great. They really understand the medical issues themselves. And I've even had a judge ask me personally as the intern about sort of what was going on with this client's medical history. So that was really great too. And lastly, the medical legal partnership is about comfort. Janine and I have done several home visits. Most of them have been better than the situation we faced with Emily to make sure that the clients are comfortable. A lot of the clients have some transportation problems, so it's really easiest for them to meet them at their home, and that's what it's all about. It's about comfort for them. The office is a completely safe space, and clients really feel that they can share everything in the kitchen sink while in our office, and I think that's something that's very important in building a relationship and trust with your client. Also, at the hospital itself, there are certain rooms that children can go in. I know that clients often bring their children with them because they don't have access to daycare, but there's, you know, a couple libraries and empty rooms that the children can play in with access to toys. And as well, whenever we do home visits, we make sure to bring coloring books and little toys for the kids to really make sure that they're comfortable as well during the meeting that Janine has with their parents. So I'm giving you guys some souvenirs from our trip to the Bahamas. I wanted you to take away from this that the medical legal partnership uses legal tools to fix social and health problems that the clients face. It's a more holistic approach to legal issues that I don't think other law firms have, and I really think that's because there's only one attorney and she has complete autonomy on how it's run, how the process works, and she can really dictate how to best serve her clients, and I found that it's very successful, and I think the clients have as well. Any questions? Oh, thank you. Your hand shot up first.
Nice, yes. First, I just wanted to say thank you. I just wanted to say I think you did a great job in spite of your voice.
Thank you.
My question, I have two questions, but I'll do one first. You had mentioned about exterminators who would go up to the houses and either provide the service at a discount or for free. Now, are there a pool of exterminators that you guys draw from, that you've had experience from, or did you reach out to them, or did they come to you?
I'm not actually sure how it works. I know a couple of them have been referrals from within the hospital, so there have been, know, relatives who may have worked at the hospital, but I know that that's been an outreach that has happened. I honestly think it's just been a passing of people's business cards, or I know someone, and I think that once that initial contact is made with the exterminators, it sort of just opens the door to getting the services, but I don't always think it's a, we don't always go to them.
Mm-hmm.
I've only ever called one exterminator myself to see if they would perform the service for free, but that was because that was in Pawtucket, and not all the exterminators in Providence, excuse me, will make the trek, which
right.
It's not even that far, but they don't want to go. So that was the only real instance of that, but I think it's been working on the network who will reach different places. You can ask your other.
Oh, you seem to do a lot of different work, whether it be getting the services outside of the legal realm that people need, or the guardianships or SSI payments. What do you think, in your experience, is the most fulfilling and most in demand work, I guess you could say?
I think it's actually a mix of both. I think a lot of clients who come in who have sick children either need a guardianship or a power of attorney. They often need a very sometimes simple and easy legal process that can be done normally rather quickly. But I think a lot of clients often come in without a legal problem just because they need help and they don't know where else to go. And I know that if the client is who has a child who is either a patient of Hasbro or themselves is a patient of Rhode Island Hospital or something else, another hospital in the lifespan, community, they're often given Janine's business card, not even knowing she's an attorney, just because they know she has resources and will do her best to meet whatever needs the client has. So I really think it honestly depends on what walks through the door that day.
Right.
Does the partnership do any follow-up? So when you get to the very end, in Emily's case, the condemnation, and I mean, I'm assuming you're helping her find an apartment to that effect. Is there any later follow-up to ensure that they're not letting this happen again to them? Or?
I joke with Janine because I almost feel like representation. Once you've been a client, I almost feel like you're never not a client. I often find that when, you know, they may have a current file, but then I go back into the archives and they have numerous, stacks. So I don't think representation really often ever ends for a lot of clients, but for other clients it does. But I think Janine is very good about following up with people, whether it be a quick email or just a voicemail, just to let them know that she's still there as a resource if they do need anything. But I really think for some clients it's a revolver. They never leave. Yeah.
For something as extreme as that example that you opened with, I mean, is there not any kind of criminal charges that are available, like for that sort of like mismanagement? And if so, like, do you ever refer these kind of cases to the local prosecutors?
So some cases get referred out. It's not really normally a criminal problem. We don't deal with a lot of criminal cases, and if we do, that's immediately referred out, just because the office does not have the resources to handle an extensive criminal proceeding like that. But
I'm sorry, maybe I missed.
Oh,
no. Like, I guess what I'm saying is that it's so egregious, you know. Like, I mean, the sorts of conditions you were talking about, I mean, I would think that there might be, I mean, it depends on the state and things like that, but I was just saying, like, would you ever call up the prosecutors and tell them, hey, you know, you should take a look at this, that type of thing? That wouldn't affect your ability to help your client.
No,
right? Yeah.
No. In the research I've done, I believe they're all civil claims.
Okay.
It doesn't happen. The AG's office. And it's not that egregious. I hate to say it, but it's not. Like,
no,
there.
And
it's more common than you think.
I've seen
people go into the bathroom in like buckets in work. I mean, it's really not. And it's the AG's office here would never. And even in New York City, you could get tenants to do a rent strike. There's different ways, but not criminal. It's a good point. I mean, in terms of thinking about the big picture, it's totally crazy that there aren't criminal charges.
No.
Sick.
And I've even seen, I haven't been to another house that was in that state, but I've seen photos of houses that were worse where Janine did not even walk in the door because she just felt that she could not safely enter the home. So it happens quite often, and I know right now Janine is working with two other private attorneys in order to represent these clients in a hopefully a civil lawsuit against their landlord. It's just oftentimes it does need to be referred out because the office is a very small nonprofit and there's often not resources to engage in a big civil lawsuit like that with just one attorney and a couple of interns. So.
I have two questions, one really quick. Is your name spelled with a C or a K?
With a K.
I thought so. Unnecessarily had to make a speaking work because of my colleague, but anyway, real question. So you already kind of said this to Don that you refer cases out, because I was wondering, like, if you had a conflict with like the public defenders or legal services, if, like, there was, if they had like a claim to a case over you guys or.
Not that I found or have ever heard of. I know that most of the cases we get are patients at the hospital, so they've often either never dealt with the public defender's office or Rhode Island Legal Services, and if they have, it's in a completely different capacity. We often don't deal with any criminal cases, so if that's in the background, that's in the background.
Right, I was just thinking, like, in terms of, like, family situations, I guess, with, like, if the kids were getting taken away or something.
I know there's involvement. Yeah, there is. We're in contact with DCYF, but I don't know that there's ever been a conflict with any other organization.
Okay.
At least in my experience, I don't believe there's been another conflict.
So,
this is, so criminal things aside, because it sounds like there's criminal or big civil stuff that gets triaged out. Is there like a screening process for, because as you said, you have very limited resources and this is a very common issue, more than I think any of us really realize. Is there like a cutoff point where, or do you take everyone that comes in the door that has XYZ?
It really depends. So I know, I'll give you this same example. So right now we are working on 4 education assessment cases. These cases are often very big. They involve a lot of paperwork and a lot of time. And I know that Janine cannot take more than 1 education case without interns there, just because she cannot handle the paperwork on her own. So if it's maxed out, unfortunately, even if they meet the criteria for representation at the program, they're unfortunately needing to be referred out. But I know that, a situation like that, Janine will try to find an attorney who will handle their case for free or an extremely low cost if the client is able to pay something. So it just really depends on what the client's need is and what we're already working on for cases like that.
How much, you just said, like, as for referrals, how receptive are attorneys in the area to be helping out?
I find that they're very receptive. I've called a few of them, and I think a lot of them are Roger Williams alums who know Janine or have been in contact with the Medical Legal Partnership in some way. So I find that most of the ones who I've met or spoken to are pretty receptive. I mean, I know that a lot of them work in public interest or are in private practice, so I think they're willing and able to take cases. And some of them aren't very expensive, so sometimes they're quick for them to handle.
That's great.
Yeah.
Kind of piggybacks off of Molly's question, but how long for somebody living in a property like that or with the bed bugs, how long does it take? I mean, I think every case would be different, but generally, like a really egregious case, how long does it take to help make the client like close to whole again, or get the remedies fixed? And like, are there programs that cover like bed bug issues where, you know, they're obviously already in a difficult situation, you know, clearly that kind of expense is like, it's gonna hit them hard. Are there programs that help?
Their funding is maxed out. So I know that there are supposed to be programs to provide rent assistance, to provide housing, but often they're, I know right now they're all full. I call every day and they're all full. So I think there are supposed to be programs like that. And I know that at Hasbro there's a program called Health Leads, who is in contact with a lot of, you know, the Catholic Diocese. They're in contact with a lot of these programs. But I just think that there are so many people who need the services that even the services that are out there are inadequate to meet the need of really the state as a whole. So I think there are programs, but they're not available. They're just maxed. And at that point, it's like, what do you, how do you help someone? How do you tell someone that the shelter is full and that they're going to be homeless? How do you tell someone that?
Yeah.
So, that's my point. Any other questions?
Stop talking.
You had a lot of questions.
Good job. Thank you, Casey. Yeah. You have 3 glasses of water.
Imagine.
I've never been to that museum, but I hear it's amazing.
the natural history movie?
Yeah.
Isn't it like Pam from the movie?
I think so.
Pam from the movie?
Oh,
hello. Oh, did you? Can, but when did you get them done?
Like during this
June or?
It was in June.
You might not be able to.
Why?
Because the cutoff for financial aid is July 1st. That's the new year that switches over for the award year. So if you don't get your reimbursement in before June or July 1st, you can't. Because they're working off a different award. So basically the reimbursement.
She never emailed me back.
Just
I've been like calling her.
Is that? I think so.
My loans have been taken out of deferment because of the office.
Oh, here.
So now I have $600 to my loans.
Wait, how did they get taken out?
Because someone thought that I was a third year that just graduated, and they reported me to
that in the mail.
They reported
you?
No, they reported me to the clearinghouse. The, like, national clearinghouse.
Yeah,
well,
you just correct them.
Well, I'm working with it, but they won't clarify until the end of August. So now I'm working with my loan company to say that, no, I'm still in school, and the loan company like, no, not report. And so I called financial, and I'm like, you need to fix this. And they're like, oh, we can't help you. We work with the undergrads, and you don't even know if we do a deferment.
Wait,
the financial
aid office could fix that right here.
No, that's what I'm saying.
You should have a financial aid or whatever.
Yeah.
Email Dean Lally.
Dean Lally.
Because there's, you know, like, Rochelle left.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, they need to be sort of alerted if it's not working right. Because I feel like undergrads are just taking over temporally.
Yeah.
So just, I would email
her. And she thought that I was
things.
An incoming student, like a brand new 1L. And so she's like, well, we don't defer.
You're
going to
put it back up?
Until then. So I'm sorry,
Jessica. I've emailed Dean Lally because I'm concerned I'm having trouble.
Yeah,
because
I'm getting
big
badgered by Navient saying, pay me.
Did you get that?
No, they just started calling me, and that's when I looked into it. Like,
yeah, because the problem, you gotta deal with that quick, because if not, then if you don't pay, then you get a negative amount of credit. You know what I mean? You don't want that.
You could get in big trouble if you.
I know.
Well, you just ask for forbearance. Just you'd say, all right, well, think of it this way: I'm not graduating from the state, but let's pretend I was. Let's pretend I can't find a job, so
you
can forbear.
Okay, that's good. I did get your email.
Oh, okay.
To Mary Kay?
Yeah,
I thought you meant a different provider. That sounds fine.
Okay,
we're going to give Jesse your full attention.
Okay.
Go for it.
All right, so this is what we're all working towards right now, right? This is, you know, I'd like everyone to take the time and think about the effort you're putting into your class and into your jobs, and, you know, think about your memories growing up at home with your families and family events and things like that. All right, now I'm going to tell you a story about somebody who also thinks a lot about that and what they have to go through when they face hard times. All right, Charles Polydor worked on Wall Street, not as a trader, but he was an IT technician. He had a good job, he had a good career going, he had family, he had, you know, everything he wanted. He had a good mortgage, he was current on his payments, he was current on all his utilities. You know, everything was going very well. And then he got laid off and the housing crisis hit. He kept paying his monthly mortgage payments and looking for new jobs. You know, but not much was out there. The market was very thin. So he started to dip into his other funds. His other funds, such as, you know, his 401k, emergency finances, you know, whatever else they had lying around, that's what they dipped into. Eventually, he had to get on welfare, and here's why. He had diabetes, and he had a very poor health condition. He was also legally blind in one eye, so he had to, you know, make sure that he was still seeing his health care and make sure that he was still marketable to these companies and was still taking care of himself because he had a family. And all in the meantime, what he's doing is he's applying to his bank for a loan modification, which is an option you have when you're in default. So he's been making his payments and dipping into all his funds, but what he had to do was apply for this modification because he couldn't afford his payments anymore, and everything he had saved up was slowly depleting and almost gone. In the meantime, his health had, you know, very much been deteriorating, and on top of that, he's dealing with these banks. So while applying for his loan modification, he's calling the banks, he's not getting through to anyone, he's submitting letters stating that he has hardship, he's submitting his bank statements, he's submitting his SSDI disability statements, and when he finally gets somebody on the phone, you know what they tell him? We don't have anything. What are you talking about? Imagine how that hits you. Going through life like this, working hard, you know, finding success, and then still dealing with personal issues on the side, but able to put that off, and then slowly it starts to unravel and go really bad. And while you're still trying to do the right things, we don't have what you've been sending. What are you talking about? Eventually, he lost his home. And, you know, this is what he's dealing with now. He has nowhere to go, no funds, no nothing. You know, he's very lucky to have family, but, you know, it's not. It's a small house, and, you know, family gets congested, and, you know, other people go through hard times, and you can't always stay there very long. So this is kind of what happens when people, with the housing crisis, going through the housing crisis, and it affects people in lots of different ways. And so what happens is, what are the policy concerns for such a thing, right? Well, in Rhode Island, one of the major issues is, what are the laws that surround bankruptcy, and how do they affect everything? So we're going to get into that a little later, but right now I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what's been going on with the Rhode Island economy for the past several years. Rhode Island right now has been hit as one of the first in the country with an unemployment rate that's very high, and first in New England and sixth in the nation with a very high unemployment rate. And so when people have inherited their own homes from, you know, parents or grandparents, and then they don't have anywhere to work, it's very difficult. When you want to go to apply for a loan modification and they ask for your income and you have to put down zero. This has impacted Rhode Island in many ways, not just with the unemployment rate, but it's had an effect on the housing market with housing prices. Most housing prices have, you know, people haven't been able to maintain their homes, and so the value drops. And when the value drops, you know, it's because it's in poor condition. You can't, you know, everyone has an agreement with their insurance company where you have to maintain your home in order to keep your coverage. Well, not everyone can do that in such a situation. And this has impacted the economy because it's fostered higher prices with lower availability for, you know, when foreclosures go through and these buildings need to be condemned because they're not livable, and there's not the funds to bring them back to a livable condition. You know, there's fewer availability for these things, and the demand goes up for more people who need housing, which really fosters higher prices and can cause a huge problem for people who are trying to get housing, or even, you know, just find some place to stay temporarily. Between 2009 and 2014, there was an estimated 11,000 foreclosures in Rhode Island. And that's a very, very high rate. And Rhode Island has been known as one of the states that's been hit the hardest by this crisis. And, you know, I'm working in the foreclosure prevention project at RILS. And I have to tell you that from seeing what clients deal with when they come in and doing research on this project, Rhode Island has really done a good job with what it's had, because slowly foreclosure The amount of foreclosures have dropped. They're still very high, but they're going down. And Rhode Island has definitely attacked this issue and made some significant changes. So what are the factors that have affected the housing crisis? Well, Rhode Island has been hit hardest by the unemployment rate. That's one factor. And so obviously with very limited income coming in, it's difficult to make these expenses, and you know, people lose their jobs, and the mortgage prices are designed, but the mortgage payments escalate as the loan moves forward. So there's not really a way to reduce that. So the only way to attack that is to, you know, get people employed, keep jobs going, and so this has been one of the big challenges in Rhode Island. In 2011, like I said, they've attacked it and it started to work, but it's a slow process, as anything is, and that's very understandable. But in 2011, there was an estimated 1,685 mortgages, and then slowly it started to go down to 2014, but it still happens at a very high rate. The first quarter of 2015 was an estimated 398 foreclosures. You figure, you know, within about 3.5 to 4 months, that's a lot, and that can still go up to 1,000, you know, and that can double or triple, or anything can cause that to escalate with one small mistake. Another factor combined with this is that still bad loans are going through because people have been living in their homes for, you know, 20, 30 years, some of them, or have inherited new homes, and the loans from the housing crisis are still going through that system. So, you know, when banks would transfer loans to other banks, they wouldn't, you know, take a category and say, this is a good one, I'll give you this one, you give me a better one. All these loans were grouped into one big system with the MERS system, and so they just really flow in big general groups, and so these get lost, and so they're still filtering through the system. Another factor, a third factor that fosters foreclosures and makes it so high is the laws surrounding foreclosures fosters a very quick process, and there's several reasons for that. One of the reasons for this is that the bankruptcy courts don't have much teeth to make banks do things. Banks have discretion and they have great lobbyists and they have received, you know, these millions and millions and billions of dollars for bailouts and, you know, trying to find where the money should go and where putting it in the right spots has obviously been a challenge, but the laws definitely favor the banks over the individual. So one of the big laws that has been being pushed for recently in Rhode Island was a mandatory mediation conference, which required, basically the law originally stated that for a mediation conference to occur, the loan must be in default for at most 120 days, so basically 4 months. When this occurs, the default occurs, the banks must send a notice to the mortgage holder saying, we can't foreclose on your home until we sit down and talk. Well, this talk is obviously, we all had contracts. It's a good faith effort to sit down and hash things out and find a solution. But because so many of these can occur in large groups, you know, one of the balancing policies is finding, you know, an economic fix to this, and that's not an easy thing in a systemic approach to things. With mediation conference, you know, you have a process where you receive notices, and that's a lot of what bankruptcy court is about. You have a right to due process and not have your property and your liberty taken from you without adequate notice. So that's a big reason for the mediation conference and the laws for a notice of default. You know, you can't just send one notice and then, you know, if he hits somebody as a big surprise, you have to send one notice of the breach. And what happens with the mediation conference is that the both parties have to sit down and use a good faith effort to sit down and find a solution and take in mediating factors into account and see if there is a solution. But part of the issue with this has been lobbying with the banks, is they found ways around this. And it's hard to say it that way, because looking at this, you have such massive amounts of money that support the economy. And so what do you do? Do you put an individual's rate ahead of a massive multi-billion dollar corporation? No. Well, yes and no. In 2013, Judge McConnell issued a stay because there were so many reports about bad faith dealings with the banks. They weren't listening to people submitting loans. And then another issue with that was there's this MERS system, a mortgage electronic recording system, where usually you have to record a default with the county recording office. With the MERS system, if they're nominated, if they're indicated by the banks as a nominee, then they don't have to record it, that system is sufficient. And there have been recent cases finding, that the mortgage isn't sufficient, the mortgage didn't sufficiently nominate the MERS system. But what happens is, for people like Mr. Polyvore, who are going through things like this, it's hard to find out who to contact. Some of these mortgages are constantly flowing through the system, and you don't know who to contact, and that's part of the reason why people don't get these phone calls back, is that maybe they might be contacting the wrong person, or there are mistakes in the system. Some of the mistakes with the MERS system have been that the notes are not always recorded. It's a huge, huge system. The note is assigned, but not the mortgage, and banks have said that that's not sufficient to make a MERS assignment proper, because MERS has been foreclosing on a lot of these places, and people will challenge that and say they can't foreclose because they're not my bank, and that's who I've been dealing with. Another issue with the MERS system has been that the mortgage is assigned to a non-member who is not the mortgage lender, and so these problems cause people to, get a hold of the bank at the wrong time, and by then, things have just, snowballed into a huge, huge problem. So what are the solutions to this? I'm sorry. Well, obviously the push has been for more mediation, but recently locally owned banks have been exempted from that. This tends more to apply to out-of-state banks and in-state banks. They still have to review all the process and show that, but they can still do that in a quick manner and get people through the system, which has been one of the major complaints by many lawyers advocating for the mediation conference to apply to everyone. Another thing is more funding for government programs to help people who are going through this. And then the third one is more funding for housing programs, because the demand is going up, but the needs aren't being met. Thank you. And does anybody have any questions? Stefano?
I'm interested about the mediation solution. You said that it was something that's being pushed, trying to be pushed through the legislature.
It's been a major issue for the past several years in Rhode Island.
Yeah.
Very major issue.
So my question is, who pays for the mediation? Would the responsibility of payment for the mediator be on the bank, or is it going to be state-funded?
It's not so clear. I think it's more of it's an expense that the bank takes on.
Yeah.
I worked in insurance before here. I think that major corporations, a lot of them should be expected to build those expenses in and be able to handle those. I think that the banks take on that expense, but it's a lot that what happens is they nominate an impartial party. I think there's a designated field for it. They're called more mediation conference coordinators. So I think that they come in and they charge a fee, and I don't know. I think I wonder, it may be split, or it might depend on the agreement. Some people who go through a foreclosure, we have a client now who has fallen on hard times, but they make a very good salary, and so it's difficult because they're trying to get caught up, but that's the issue. They felt like for $18,000 behind, and so finding a solution when there's a high salary, the mortgage isn't, the bank isn't going to budge on the mortgage, and this person needs to account for that. And so, you know, a mortgage that was, you know, $3,000 a month now goes up to, you know, $3,800 or $4,200 a month to get caught up. And so, you know, to answer your question, the mediation conference is usually probably funded by the banks, but it's a big expense, but it's one that should definitely be accounted for. Don?
Wait, if you file bankruptcy and you're like 18 grand behind, like, you can't cram it down. Sorry, I took bankruptcy, so like,
no.
You can't cram it down like you would have, like a...
No.
But you can, they will cure the default. In other words, if you're being 18,000 behind, they can roll that back into the rest of your...
Right.
Right?
Right. They can, they roll it out, they extend out the loan further, they add on to the years, but what happens is some of these banks don't want to do that. They, you know, you have this massive contract for like, you know, 400,000 or... you know, 250,000 for some people, or whatever the amount is, and, you know, the crisis hits and some of these home values drop and the banks want their money. That's it. The end result is they want to get their money back. And they don't really care about, you know, not all of them, but, you know, there are people out there who handle this and they don't really think about the bigger picture that they could make it back. They want to get it and they want to get it now.
Yeah.
And so...
And then also, I was just going to ask, I don't remember, but what's the system of state exemptions like? Because like when you declare bankruptcy, you can either use the federal exemptions, which are crap in most cases, but like, or you can also use the state exemptions. And like the thing that like most people know about usually is that the homestead exemption, so you can protect like a certain amount of equity in your home when you file bankruptcy. Like, you know, most famously, like Florida has unlimited one. But is the one in Round high, and is there any like push in like the state legislature or anything like that to push a more consumer friendly thing where people can protect more of the equity in the home?
I'm not sure I'm answering your question the right way. I think I am, but the state exemptions, like the mediation conference. A mediation conference is not required for state-based banks in Rhode Island. So it's, you know, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac are not exempt. And then if it's not your primary residence, then there is no mediation conference required at all. They don't have to follow that procedure. They can just move on to the next step. It really deals with the primary residence, and that's where the due process issue comes in. But from our experience with the lack of availability of apartments, it still is a due process issue because there's not enough availability and there's a higher demand. One of the recently new things going on now is a housing lottery. You know, you have to record your name by email with a housing system and then they will call you. So that's how they get it, or they'll email you. But it's difficult because even though the housing, or the people there, the numbers are growing, and with the housing availability of apartments shrinking, you know, that's one of the major issues going on. Any other questions?
I had one. It's kind of combining both of those.
Yeah.
So we have mediation solution funding. This is where, is there
funding.
Proposals for where that's coming from, taxes, or just...
I know it's difficult to find the funding right now. People propose a lot. Peter Kilmartin has been making proposals, and they haven't exactly gone through. A lot of the bills that have been recently, not a lot, but some of the bills for funding have been being killed through the Senate and the Congress, from what I've been reading about. Lack of availability for funding and where to direct that to has been one of the major issues.
Good question.
great job. They were very interesting. Hopefully you learned a little bit more each of your lives. So finish up the critiques. We'll give you 5 minutes. And again, if you don't have time to finish them, just send them, scan them in, send them to me. If you presented last week or this week and you haven't given me the mooting feedback sheet of someone who watched you before, I need that.
Are we graded on the effectiveness of who, like, their commentary?
No, I mean, the rubric tells you it's like that you, there should be some, when I look at the moot feedback sheet and your presentation, there should be some correlation between adjusting.
Okay.
If I can't see it, then there's something.
Okay. Because getting her to elaborate was
well,
not
that's fine. Yeah. We just started to try to do that because I found that.
She was like, great job. I'm like, no, I need more.
She didn't really give proper critique.
Yeah, she's not very good at the whole critique.
I know he felt bad. He said, I don't want to see it.
Yeah, I had the same thing. I'm like, just give me more. Other than, oh, that's fine.
All right, you did great.
Okay, so feel free to keep writing or you can wait, but I'm gonna sort of move ahead so you can get out of here. In terms of the TED Talk, again, I'll repeat, I need your self-critique. So if you didn't hand in, like, Don, I don't know if you sent me your self-critique. You didn't. I need your self-critique and I need that mooting feedback sheet before I'll give you the rubric as well as your peer critiques. I'll scan them all and you'll get like a packet of critiques, of the critiques. So that's the TED Talk. Next week, our last class. I know, you'll be sad. please bring a copy of The Good Lawyer, the copy that's tattered and has been to the beach all summer with you, with notes. Bring a copy of the book with you. I'm gonna give you back my feedback on reflection 3 and 5. That should be the last in terms of my feedback. I think I had somehow forgotten to give you 3. So I'm going to give you 3 and 5 tonight, and you'll see little note cards on the top. I want each of you to write either 2 questions or sort of topics. The beginning of next week's class, we'll be talking about The Good Lawyer and sort of connections that you found with your summer, with your externship this summer, or maybe sort of broader things that resonated, anything you want from the book. Think of it as sort of like a book group discussion. So you've got 2 note cards on each note card, either a question or like a topic. And to the extent you have a page number or a quote, better yet. But just think, if I pull your card out, it's got to be something that will get people talking. I don't care what chapter, I don't care where it's from. Okay, so if you look at the index cards, you each have 2 index cards. Bring them to class, I'll put them in my magic hat. And that'll help us start the discussion. I'll bring pizza next week. Pizza party! pizza party. So that's next week. I had said bring copies of your resume next week, but actually I was thinking this over while you guys got Gray's ice cream. Send me a copy, you can do 2 things. If you really want to be practical and you want to like put this summer's experience right on your resume and your resume's up to date, just send me your resume. That would be just electronically, send me your resume. If you feel like your whole resume isn't quite where you want it to be and you don't want me looking at it, that's fine. Do the blurb for this summer. Because what I think I'll do is put all of your blurbs on 1 sheet of paper. And I found that students really appreciate this. It's like one of those things that like it's easier to do it now than to like wait until you need to update your resume in October. So we'll all sort of help each other look at that new blurb. Does that make sense? So you can either send me the text in an email, that's fine, like just in the body of the email, or send me your resume. I don't care. But I will take it and I'm gonna put it all into 1 document. We're all gonna sort of help each other make that blurb sound the best that they can. So that'll be sort of the second half of class. Make sense? Obviously, you should be finishing the book if you haven't already, starting to think about the paper. You weren't here last week, but I told everyone it's due Saturday. It's not due next Wednesday. Saturday at 11:59, in case there's any confusion about midnight, p.m., a.m. What else? Resume, questions. I think that's it. And then in terms of just bridges and making sure everyone's up to date on assignments, Jesse, Don, and Obi are the only people I just want to quickly just make, don't worry, it's like not bad, I just want to make sure that their stuff uploaded. Everyone else, you're free, you're dismissed.
Hey.
Be careful of the flash flood. Mm-hmm. Obi, the only thing you're missing is the final mid-semester evaluation.
I just
upload it. Just so that I have whatever you gave your supervisor.
Final.
You know, like we went back and forth, but whatever you sent to Susan, just make sure when you go to Bridges, the final folder does not have anything attached to it.
The final evaluation?
Mid-semester.
Oh,
the meeting.
Let's see that.
Back and forth. Same thing for you. I still don't have the final up there. Whatever you
put,
the evaluation itself isn't in that folder. It's not, this is not a big deal. I just like, you know, whatever you say.
I really,
that's not.
And then I also
debrief
need
whether
they
mooted it.
Didn't do that.
Yep.
Yeah, that
was actually, one of the things is I did do it, but when I went and ran it up to the my car was so messy,
okay,
they'll attest that I had to make a line for him. So I threw all my crap on like one side of the car, and now I don't really have it. So I'm just
gonna do a new one. So get that up. And then the TED Talks self-critique from last week. And then
I became. I'm gonna email you about the tax.
Yes, that'd be great. Good. Good. Yay! Someone's gonna help me.
Can you repeat the assignment with the questions?
Yes. So, oh wait, don't leave. Wait, don't leave.
Oh,
wait. I didn't give you your feedback.
Oh, oh
that's
yours.
Sorry.
Anybody's feedback?
Come
where's
down.
Where's that Casey and Molly?
I think they're already gone.
Oh, they're gone.
Go get them.
I booked.
Jesse. Okay, Stefano, scream for them.
Thank you.
Cameron, so it's just the ladies, right?
We fill out the cards next week, right?
Next week. Bring them to class. We'll put them in the magic hat.
Okay.
You're
supposed to have read the whole book.
And know my page numbers there.
What did you say about bringing questions?
So, something about it was like a good quote or something that you related to your job, like a page number that you found really, that's going to like generate discussion, like something that you really took from the book. Right?
Sorry.
So we're supposed to generate, like, a good question or something that we got out of the book that
was
related to...
Yeah, like the class could... So I found on page 429 this quote really resonated with me.
And
let's chat. Discuss.
Okay. Got it.
Discuss.
Discuss.
So, Jesse, what am I... The only thing I'm missing... Oh, I'm missing your meeting debrief form.
I got that email. I'm sorry.
You don't have to apologize.
Just
get it up.
Just get it in.
Can I just
get it
diverted?
Stop bothering
again. Friday or Saturday, I just have a plan tomorrow.
Yeah.
So with that, alright. So I'll have a few. Sorry.
Yeah. I'm
like
we just gotta get this Bridges up to speed,
yeah,
so that I can give you your evaluation.
Here's my mooch.
Beautiful. Beautiful.
And all of mine are in one nice deep pile there.
That's it.
Why aren't you the little goody two shoes?
It was kinda, I have to say, the TED Talk is kinda hard for other reasons when you're trying, at least for like when your audience is lawyers, you're trying not, my whole writing this, I was trying not to focus on offending. Like for me, I like.
Offending people with bankruptcy
well,
law?
I know like Stefano works in the legislature and I don't know where, you know, I know like it's important. I know a lot of people who like, some people side, you know, you can't do this to the homeowner. And I agree with that. And then there's others where it's, you know, you can't also overlook a contract. And so finding that middle,
yeah,
you know, I didn't want to, like, you know, paint the banks. I don't know if people.
Well, you should. I mean, I feel like
work.
A presentation like this, you
yeah.
have the liberty to be, you can have an opinion,
yeah.
you can go middle of the road, like you sort of, you know,
yeah.
you have to make a decision sort of how you want to present.
Yeah.
And you also think, like, if you are really working at RILS and you're doing a community presentation, you have to, that's why
yeah.
I emphasize like who's your audience and really tailoring the talk. I mean, there may be political reasons to make yourself really left and really left, or there may be reasons to go the other way or go middle of the road.
I think like what I was worried about, like I didn't know if anyone had family working in the banks that like
anything. You can't be worried about all that.
Yeah.
You can't be like worried about
my
that.
My topic
you know.
With mental
you
health.
Know what, you know what the best part is? If you just say what the hell it is you think, you can piss people off, you get a lot of good Q&A.
I think that's right.